Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the August 23rd meeting, which reconvenes our meeting from August 16th of the City of Portsmouth Planning Board. We have several people missing tonight, but we do have a quorum, and so Mr. Clark will be voting. And the first order of business is public hearing, old business. Item A, the application of John and Joan Dickinson, owners for property located at 220 Walker Bungalow Road, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 on the zoning ordinance for work within the tidal wetland buffer to demolish the existing home detached garage, construct a new 1,968 square foot single family residence with attached 756 square foot garage, a new septic system, and the relocation of the driveway with 8,990 square feet of impact to the wetland buffer. Said property is shown in assessor's map 223 as lot 21 and lies within the single residence B district. Who is here to speak for this application?
Yes, good evening, thank you. I'm Steve Riker from AMBA Engineering, representing John and Joan Dickinson for property owned at 220 Walker Bungalow Road in Portsmouth. As stated, this is a conditional use permit for work within the 100-foot City of Portsmouth wetland buffer. This is the C1 existing conditions plan. There's an existing single-family home located here. There's an existing detached garage located here. These two structures are connected with some asphalt and a driveway that accesses this garage off from Walker Bungalow Road. That asphalt extends in this direction and sort of creates an apron here in front of the house. The existing septic system is located right here. The proposal is to raise the existing home, the existing detached garage, and construct a new home on the lot. The new home will be located approximately here. The proposal also will replace the existing septic system with an AOS septic system, as well as in the location where the garage will be removed, a rain garden will be constructed. The rain garden will treat stormwater runoff from the roof of the proposed home via gutter and downspout. In addition to those items, the proposed driveway that comes off Walker Bungalow Road will be right here, which will provide access to the garage, attached garage on the home located here. In your packet, there should be a landscape plan from Terra Firma Architects located here in Portsmouth. They've put together a landscape plan, which is essentially a buffer planting plan, which provides a nice buffer planting area pretty much along the entire shoreline of the property. You just navigate here from plan to plan. This plan here shows the impacts. This is the limit of the 100-foot tidal buffer zone. This is the 50-foot primary structure setback. That's a state setback. We have less structure in the 50 under the proposed project, as well as less structure in the 100-foot buffer under the proposed project. The project also utilizes project also utilizes porous pavement for construction of the driveway. As a result, we have a decrease in impervious surface under proposed conditions. We attended the Conservation Commission meeting last month and received unanimous recommendation of approval for this project. We did go through two meetings with them. After the first meeting, we reduced the size of the home quite a bit, reduced the size of the deck to gain their approval. And with that, I will take any questions.
Questions for the applicant? Mr. Clark?
A couple questions. The first is, do you guys proposing to use crushed stone underneath the deck? Is the deck gonna be, have the ability to infiltrate water through the boards on the deck?
And it would, but we haven't proposed crushed stone under the deck. We could do that.
Okay. And then my other question is, on the landscape plan, you show like a hatched area kind of along all the along all the buffer plantings. It says seeded area. And...
Yes.
I'm assuming that is the quote-unquote buffer area, including all that hatched stuff?
Yes, so the entire area is the buffer planting area.
Okay.
The area that you see seeded, we've called out a specific three-species seed mix that does well adjacent to tidal waters. The state likes to see those three grass species.
All right. I guess my follow-up question is, what's the plan for fertilizer in that area?
There is none. You're not allowed to use it. And I think we have there's a note on one of our plans.
Because on sheet D1 under vegetative practice, I just saw kind of the standard fertilizer note.
Yes. So. Yep. On C3, note number 6, we cite the actual City of Portsmouth ordinance for use of fertilizers.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Other questions for the applicant? What is the current footprint? What's the footprint of the current house and garage?
Good question. I can get you that info.
I didn't see it on the plans.
Yep. So on C3 in the upper left-hand corner is the impervious surface chart. And if you look, the very first line item is main structure and garage.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Other questions for the applicant? Mr. Gamester.
Steve, just curious, is there any... We just recently started talking about this. I don't recall us talking about it before, but... is there any maintenance plan for the porous paver dry? Okay, there is.
Yes, yeah. There should be an inspection and maintenance plan in your packet. There is a typo under the porous pavement section that I need to fix, that I will fix. It references asphalt, and it should say porous pavement instead of asphalt.
Well, then, fantastic. Thank you. I must admit.
Are there questions for the applicant? Thanks. I'll open it up to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. That's the wish of the board. Ms. Walker.
So in light of the comment related to fertilizer, I did note that the detail does reference fertilizer, so I would suggest that maker of the motion, additional stipulation would be to remove any reference to fertilizer where it is not in compliance with the city's ordinances and state requirements.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we vote to grant the wetland conditional use permit with the following stipulations, 1 and 2 in the planning department memorandum, as well as the removing all other language in the plans with fertilizer to remain consistent with note 6 on sheet C3.
We have a motion.
Second.
Second discussion.
Can I just ask the maker? I'd like to include the crushed stone below the wood deck.
Yep. Number 4 stipulation would be this crushed stone underneath the deck. Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, motion is second with amended. They will have crushed stone underneath the deck. Discussion. So you now call the motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion passes 6-0. Thank you. Item B, the application of Robert and Whitney West Hall owners for property located at 198 Essex Ave. The applicants have requested this be postponed. If I could have a motion to postpone this application to the September 27th.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Item C, the application of Pease Development Authority owner, Alonza Biologetics Inc. applicant for property located at 70 and 80 Corporate Drive. This application has been postponed to coincide with the applications for subdivision and site plan review, and there's no need to take a vote. Public hearing, new business. The application of Swirly Girl 2 LLC owner for property located at 244 South Street, requesting amended conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017. of the zoning ordinance for work within the inland wetland buffer for the reconstruction of a retaining wall, relocation of granite steppers, relocation of low retaining wall, increased permeable walkway and driveway, and increased plant and buffer enhancement areas with 1,091 square feet of impact to the wetland buffer, resulting in a net reduction of impervious surface of 133 square feet. Said property is shown in Assessor's Map 111 as Lot 3 and lies within the single residence B district. Who's here to speak for this application?
Good evening. My name is Amber Lilderholm with Pinecoast Landscape. I'm here tonight representing Swirly Girl 2 for property located at 244 South Street. Also in attendance is Steve Riker with Ambit Engineering and homeowner Lori Kennedy. I'm here tonight to discuss the proposed amendment for the conditional use permit granted for the property on 6/15/2017, and also to discuss changes to the Ambit Engineering conditional use permit plan dated June 5th, 2017. The purpose of the amendment is to show the landscape plans approved utilizing existing and proposed grades and permeability factors that were set forth by Ambit Engineering to mitigate the disturbance within the buffer and increase the functionality in terms of its landscape. I just want to run through the, I have both plans on here. I just want to go through the changes. So on the tenant side walkway, there was originally this section of walkway was approved for 100 square feet, a split between standard brick and permeable brick. What we're proposing is to keep this whole area permeable to infiltrate stormwater coming in from the road. So we're increasing the square footage from 100 square feet to 170 square feet. Also coming along down this side, there was a low retaining wall drawn in against the fence, and for grade purposes we feel as though the retaining wall is needed along here. You can see on this plan just to better retain that grade and hold the grade in place. Additional granite steps will be needed for access to accommodate the grade changes. There's a low retaining wall that was, if you see the site photos, there was an existing stone wall on the property pre-construction that was dismantled and put aside. What we're proposing is to essentially rebuild that wall to better retain the grade coming down along the tenant side. Most of the material will be used from on-site materials with a little supplemental granite. Any backfill for the wall will be used from on-site materials. The wall will only be approximately 30 square feet and a foot and a half tall. There are also added peystone sitting areas on the tenant side here and in the backyard here. For functionality of the landscape, they won't add anything to the pervious surface. The drywalls that were in the original plan will stay as is, same maintenance plan, same location, located on the rear of the property. We have increased the plant bed and buffer enhancement areas from 622 square feet to 1,852 square feet. The original buffer enhancement area all along the back of the property directly abutting the edge of wetlands. That will remain the same with the same spec'd plants, clethora and myrica, in a mix of native grasses. It'll remain no mow. But what we've done is add additional planting areas on the property boundaries and also by the driveway in the backyard, an increase of 300%. We have also relocated steppers from the front yard to the backyard. In the original plan, they were drawn in right here. And for ease of use in the landscape to go from the driveway into through the plant bed into the lawn, we have relocated those steppers. the driveway area was proposed to be 581 square feet of permeable, and standard asphalt was to remain on the top area. And it kind of created this weird transition piece. So what we proposed to do is add 126 square feet of permeable to that, so that now the transition would be off the corner of the deck, which will increase the square footage of permeable and better infiltrate the stormwater. These changes will result in a net reduction of impervious surface by 133 square feet, bringing the lot coverage down from 28.4% to 26.6%. So we feel that this plan is an improvement on AMBIT's original plan, but we wanted to work within the confines of their grades and their permeability set forth while limiting disturbance to the buffer. The retaining walls, I feel as though they'll hold the grade in place better, slowing water and sediment from the wetlands, and also incorporating additional permeable walkway and driveway square footage will be offsetting the impervious changes that were necessary on the plan, better infiltrating water from the road and decreasing stormwater. With that, I will take any questions.
Questions for the applicant? Thank you. I'll open it up to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. It's the wish of the board.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we vote to grant the wetland conditional use permit as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion?
Just say it's a good job that they've come back and made it even better, so yeah. Thank you.
Agreed. Thank you. I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion passes 6-0. Thank you. Item B. The application of Michael and Denise Todd, owners for property located at 254 South Street. Requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the inland wetland buffer for the addition of a 157 square foot deck and 140 square foot ground level patio in crushed stone or permeable pavers, and additional plantings on the east side to offset the disturbance, with 297 square feet of impact of the wetland buffer. Said property shown in assessor's map 111 as lot 4 and lies within the single residence B district and the historic district. Who's here to speak for this application?
I am. I'm Denise Todd, the owner at 254 South Street. So my proposal is exactly as you see it. I drew it out, and where the plan is to build an additional section on the deck that we already have, some of which is in the 100-foot buffer line, the curved one that you see on the drawing. Just that corner of it, and then the new section would be all totally, apart from a tiny little bit in the corner, would all be in the wetland buffer section. The purpose of this, and we couldn't figure another section of the yard to try and get some storage for mowers and bicycles and the snowblower, and this seemed like the possible solution to that. So the proposal was to build underneath the corner, not the step section of the deck on the west side, but the east side, the square section, to build a storage, watertight storage underneath it, which would create some roof runoff. The deck is about 10 feet by 10 and a half feet. So that area would create some runoff for the roof underneath, which we proposed putting a crushed stone to continue. We already have crushed stone just about all the way to the end of the existing deck. And then we'd continue that past the new portion of the deck and into some of the patio area to take some of that drainage away. And if it needed a gutter if it was proposed that it needed a gutter, we'd do it, but the plan was to put one of the pipes about 18 inches deep with holes in it and then fill it with crushed stone, and that would be about 1.5 to 2 feet wide in that section. And then put some kind of patio, and it probably would be crushed stone, we're not sure, on that, something that helps it all drain. Our whole house drains from the street to the rear, so everything will stay graded the way it is. We're proposing, under the existing deck, there's already crushed stone, and then in the new section, the previous owner had a hot tub down here, and it's already crushed stone in that section, so we just leave that. For the water that goes through the existing deck can still run underneath the proposed flooring of the storage area, so that would stand off the ground slightly with some kind of boards, however the builder suggests to build the flooring. So the hopefully the disturbance would be minimal. And then we put in more garden area to the east side of the house to mitigate some of that.
Questions for the applicant?
Does that explain it?
Thank you. I'll open it to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. I have a motion to grant the wetland conditional use permit as presented.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we vote to grant the wetland conditional use permit as presented. And I'd probably just add as a stipulation that just to note that the patio area be either crushed stone or permeable pavers. Just to include it in there. There you are.
Second.
We have a motion and second discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion passes 6-0. Thank you. Item C, the application of Mary A. Mahoney, owner for property located at 206 Northwest Street, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the tidal wetland buffer for the removal of the existing paved driveway and walkway in an existing 127 square foot screen house, and the construction of a 23 foot by 25 foot two car garage with a permeable driveway and walkway with 1700 square feet of impact to the wetland buffer. Said property is shown on assessor's map 122 as lot 6 and lies within the general residence A district and the historic district. And before you make your presentation, could you just clarify whether in fact it's 1700 square feet or is it 2238 square feet of impact? Because I saw a revised application.
Yes, yeah, I have 2238.
So it's 2238. So
yeah.
So we'll change that record to show that it has an impact of 2,238 square feet to the wetland buffer. So who's here to speak for this application?
Good evening again. Steve Riker from AMBA Engineering, here representing Mary A. Mahoney for property located at 206 Northwest Street. Winter Holbin Architecture and Design out of Kittery, Maine, brought me in on this project recently to help them with the permitting process. So I was a part of helping them produce these plans and show all the necessary items that they needed to depict on these plans to gain approval, as well as aided them in the development of the buffer planting plan that you see here. But essentially, there's a single family residential home located here. There's an outbuilding located approximately here. There's a screen house located right here. And this plan is difficult to sort of decipher, but there's an existing asphalt driveway that comes off Northwest Street and runs to a point to right here. The proposal is to construct a two-car garage in this location, remove this asphalt driveway, construct a pervious paver driveway that accesses the garage, and there's an existing concrete walkway that leads from the existing driveway to the door of the home here. That walkway will be removed, and that'll be also a pervious paver walkway under post-construction conditions. In reference to the change in the amount of disturbance, originally what was calculated was the exact square footage of the structures, and a small envelope around that area wasn't accounted for construction purposes, so that is the discrepancy in the number that you have on the application. There is an exhibit in here that's pretty nice. Let me just navigate to it right here. Color-coded, the top one shows what's being removed. The pink or the orange is what's being removed. There's a screen house located here. That's being removed as part of this proposal. On the bottom is the new, the garage, the pervious paver driveway, the pervious paver walkway, and the buffer planting plan. I was not part of the HDC meetings, but I believe this project went to three HDC meetings, and that is why the garage is located where it is. That's where HDC wanted to have it. It could be closer to the road and further away from the wetland, but per HDC, that was the location they decided upon. I just wanted to explain that that's why it's there, not further away. In your packet, I believe there's a pervious paver detail that shows the paver that they're going to utilize. The buffer planting plan has two species of plants that'll be planted. Currently, it's essentially lawn right to the water's edge. There's an existing timber bulkhead here that transitions to some upland, and we think that the buffer planting plan is also a great addition to the property. Overall, there's a decrease in impervious surface, so stormwater will be much improved that leaves this lot and enters North Mill Pond. And with that, I'll take any questions.
Questions for the applicant? Mr. Clark.
I see in the packet you guys included the detail for the stone drip apron. Is your intention to put that onto the plans, or because I know it on sheet 3 it doesn't show the detail, so I just curious to see how that was going to get
good question, Corey. It is on there. It's really hard to see on the plan. On my 11 by 17 you can barely see a small hatched area on the southwest side and the northeast side of the garage.
Okay.
That is the location of the drip
aprons.
On the plan.
Okay.
Yep.
Gotcha.
Other questions for the applicant? Thank you, Steve. I'll open it up to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. Can I have a motion to grant the wetland conditional use permit as presented?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I move that we vote to grant the wetland conditional use permit as presented.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion passes 6-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item D, the application of Seacoast Development Group LLC owner for property located on Rockingham Ave, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the inland wetland buffer for the removal of 285 square foot foundation with 1187 square feet of temporary impact and 654 square feet of permanent grading impacts to the inland wetland buffer. Said property is shown in assessor's map 235 as lot 2 and lies within this single residence B district. Who's here to speak for this application?
Andrew Gray with DF Moran Engineering. Evening, ladies and gentlemen of the board. Yeah, this lot is a near the intersection of I-95 and Route 4, across from the interstate from the state liquor store. Originally was a 1.7 acre lot, which was divided into three lots. This is a 0.88 acre lot. And this represents the furthest southwest lot of that three-lot subdivision. The western two-thirds of the lot are taken up by a wetland and drainage restoration easement. As you can see, there are wetlands down at the on the west end of this property. They're an isolated wetland that doesn't necessarily feed into or out of any known surface water. As well, on this property, there are drainage easements for the city of Portsmouth on the north and south frontages along this. My understanding is those were intended for ditching to allow runoff and treated water from this development to go down to those wetlands. The existing features on this lot is a very old, unkept asphalt driveway and an unused concrete foundation, which it's not clear if that ever actually supported a built house or not. Regardless, they are not used. The foundation itself straddles the 100-foot buffer line. Everything else, the driveway is entirely out of the buffer. So the scope of the work for this lot is to remove that existing foundation, construct a new house, a driveway, and then the drainage features, which were proposed as part of tax review of the subdivision, which was approved earlier this year. Those features include ditching on the north end and a bioretention area, or rain garden, whichever you refer to it as. It was one of the conditions of approval that gutters from all houses in this must be directed into rain gardens and receive treatment before entering the ditch along the north side. So the work items which require the conditional use permit are just the incursions into the 100-foot buffer. That would be the removal of the old foundation, a tiny portion of the proposed new paved driveway, just a matter of a couple feet, the ditch grading along the north side, and the removal of two trees which are over 6 inches. Those are the only trees that'll actually be the only trees over 6 inches that'll actually be impacted. They're shown approximately there. So on August 8th, the Conservation Commission unanimously voted to recommend approval for this project. So I believe we should request approval for it. I'll take questions.
Questions for the applicant? Thanks for the presentation. I'll open it up to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Chairman, I'll go ahead and I'll make a motion that we vote to grant the wetland conditional use permit with the following one stipulation in the planning board staff recommendation memo.
Second.
Motion is second. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The motion passes 6-0. Thank you. Item E, the application is City of Portsmouth School Department owner for property located at 32 Van Buren Ave, which is Dondero Elementary School, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the inland wetland buffer for playground renovations, including the replacement and or relocation of old play structures and play areas, creating multiple earthen mounds and imported sculptured earth on the edge of the wetland with 2,259 square feet of impact to the inland wetland and 15,500 square of impact to the inland wetland buffer. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 250 as Lot 106 and lies within the Municipal District. Who's here to speak for this application?
Good evening. Ken Lynch, Facility Director for Portsmouth Schools. Also with us, we have Kate Callahan, Dondero Principal, who will give the overall summary of the project, and Terrence Parker, our landscape architect.
Great. Thanks, Ken.
Good evening and thank you. So I'm Kate Callahan, principal at Dondero, and for the past 2 years we have been working on moving from our playground that we currently have into a more of a nature-based playground. And so this is a community effort between our faculty at school, parents, as well as Terrence, who has become a huge champion of this project. And so what we're trying to do is replace the existing equipment. We have surveyed both parents, children, and staff to replace some of the structures as a climbing structure, and then incorporate rocks and slides and more nature-based materials where students can explore and play. And through that, we've talked to Peter Britz and we have talked to David Moore, and they have come out to the site to help support our endeavor, as well as to make sure that what we're doing is in compliance with the surrounding area. I'm going to pass this on to Terrence so he can add kind of the 2 cents into the design part of this.
Thank you, Kate.
Hello, I'm Terrence Parker of Terra Firma Landscape Architecture. Yeah, to summarize what Kate said, we've been working with the city to, it's a city property, and there's a lot of athletic fields there, so part of the nature playground is in the setback from the wetland. So we're not in, on this, for the 2008 portion that you see there, we've taken off from the master plan the boardwalk that would go through the wetlands, that would expose the kids to, you know, the wetland climate in there, and the shelter and stage area that you can see on this overall master plan, that's up here, it's in that upper corner. So what you see here is only the things that impact.
You need to speak into the microphone.
Yeah, sorry about
Thanks.
That. What you see here is only the elements that impact the setback from the wetland. So the wetland is really exactly defined by the existing tree canopy, which is more evident probably in the color one. So that wetland line goes, it is a big rectangle up there, and there's a soccer field and a cricket field and a softball field all in there as well. So our focus is on doing the natural playground elements, which include the climbing mounds, a rope dome, slides and swings, traditional ones. The climbing mounds are not traditional. There's log walks, and there's some musical instrument stands. But the master plan includes the boardwalk, which you, Dexter, you cited that that impact in the wetland is strictly for the boardwalk, which mm-hmm. we're probably not doing in 2018. There's also the larger part of the work, we extend the fire lane away from the building, so the fire lane is the bulk of the impervious surface, in additional surface, additional payment for the impervious surface is all for the fire lane. And that's that gets pushed out from the school, so the school can use some of the pavement that's immediately closer to the school for free sand play and water play in the sand. So we're carving out some pavement. So we need to push into the existing pavement for play elements, and therefore push the fire lane out of the playground into the grassy area. So another big part of this is that, I don't know if you know the school, but there's a lot of serious puddling around the building. So a larger part of this is going to be to do drain inlets that will daylight into a swale that will then carry the water off of the pavement away from the building and then into the wetlands. So there'll be some stormwater treatment with that. And that'll be a pollinating area, so we'll inhabit that with native plant materials so that kids can glean some educational value out of that. But that's not a part of this proposal. That's part of the master plan. All that stormwater work and the athletic fields are out of the wetland setback at this point and not part of this proposal. So this proposal is strictly with the playground materials that happen in that setback. I just wanted to give you a little bit about the master plan, see, and that's all evident on this color rendering here, not evident on that.
All right. Questions for the applicant? Ms. Walker.
So can you clarify again, because I just want to make sure what the board knows that they're approving tonight. So the impact to the inland wetland buffer is not part of this, or the impact to the inland
wetland? Well, we're within the buffer, but we're not in the wetlands, I think.
Right. So the 2,259 square feet of impact to the inland wetland is not part of your presentation tonight?
No, I mean,
okay.
No.
So you guys plan to come back to the board when you're ready to do that part?
That's correct.
Okay. So if and when you're ready to make a motion, you might want to just clarify that.
So that's being deleted.
So the 2,259 square feet of impact to the inland wetland is not part of the consideration.
Thanks for the clarification. Questions for the applicant? So, great project, by the way.
Thank you.
Both my kids went there, and I'm looking forward to maybe my grandchildren playing on the slide.
Well, that, hopefully that happens. But the school, the administrator, and the PTA are just incredible to work with.
Do you have a timeline yet established for the completion of this
For the
project?
Completion, no, we don't have that timeline.
Just curious more than anything. Kate?
So I'm thinking phase one really is the relocation of the current equipment as well as some of the equipment that we're hoping to purchase, as well as boulders and slides and that piece. And then as we continue to do more fundraising and develop more of this plan. I'm thinking over the next 4 years. It'll then incorporate our gardens so that we can make sure those students who want more of a quiet area to play can be part of that, and there's proper supervision. And so we as a PTA and as a staff have worked together to really say, what are the essentials to do in 2018? What are the hopes of 2019 and the dreams of 2020?
So the hope is phase one would be completed ASAP. Next year, 2019?
That's correct, this year, yes.
Okay, terrific. Other questions for the applicant? Thanks, Kate. I'll open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we vote to grant the wetland conditional use permit as presented without, as stated in the chair's notice, without the 2,259 square feet of impact to the inland wetland.
Second.
The motion, second, discussion.
Where was this when I went to school at Don Darrow? I'm going to have to go back there and just play myself now, which is fine.
I'm there with you. Great, great project. No questions. I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? The motion passes 6-1. Congratulations. Nice project. The application of Robert J. and Susan Nowak, owners for property located at 350 Little Harbor Road, requesting amended conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the wetland buffer for replacement of the entrance gate, expansion of the driveway width, and turning radii using permeable pavers, the installation of 4 AC units on the eastern side of the garage, reconfiguration of retaining walls and walkways, and the addition of a security gate at the western entrance with 1,471 square feet of impact to the wetland buffer. Said property is shown in Assessor's Map 202 as Lot 16 and lies within the single residence A district.
Can I just say one?
Sure, Ms.
Walker. Before you open it up, we made copies of what was presented to the CONCOM just so for comparison, because there have been revisions made. So I'll pass those up.
Great. So in fact,
this is the previous version, just so you have it for comparison of what they're presenting tonight.
And note that I believe because of the conservation committee's feedback, the application has been amended, and so we'll make sure that if this is voted, we catch that amendment, and it will be different than what I just read into the record. Right. So who's here to speak for this application?
Yeah, thank you. Steve Riker again from Amba Engineering, representing Robert and Susan Nowak, for owners at 350 Little Harbor Road in Portsmouth. This is an amendment request. This project was originally approved in September of 2016 by this board. I don't know if any of these members here were members then, but this was a pretty large project. A lot located here had an existing home on it. The proposal then was to tear down the home, build a new home, a new driveway, access, pretty much new everything. To get you familiar with the plan quickly, there's a line up here, a green line, that is the wetland boundary. And I want to add that this plan is the landscape plan provided by Woodburn & Company out of Newmarket, New Hampshire. They are the landscape architect working on the project. There are four items as part of this amendment's request tonight. Due to some feedback by the Conservation Commission, I believe we had 7 original items. We removed 3 of those that they weren't in favor of, and we went forward with the 4 that they appeared to be okay with at the meeting. And I'll explain those 4 items briefly, and then I'll take questions. The first item is, again, the green line is the wetland boundary. The heavy black line you see is the 100-foot wetland buffer. Originally approved was a gate located right here. As you can see, actually the wetland buffer goes directly between the 2 gate posts. There's 2 gate posts. The proposal is to widen this gate from 12 feet to 18 feet to accommodate any larger vehicle that needs to turn and come into the driveway, like a UPS truck. As you can see, like I said, there's only one post from the gate that's actually located in the buffer. The second item is this retaining wall right here alongside the driveway in very tight quarters to the wetland area. The originally approved retaining wall was a modular concrete type retaining wall, and what we're proposing is a solid poured retaining wall in the same exact footprint, same exact dimensions. There's no encroachment on the wetland, just a different construction material. It's actually not a different material, it's still concrete. The concern is that if a car were ever to bump into that modular concrete wall, it would probably damage it, whereas a solid concrete wall, the car would probably be damaged. The third item is an oversight on our part. The applicants need to install 4 AC units located right here. There was originally approved generator in this location and also a boulder retaining wall. And when I say boulder retaining wall, essentially utilizing 3 boulders that are already on site to accommodate a little flat spot to put the 4 AC units right here next to the garage that's under construction. The last item is a slight expansion of this stone walkway in front of the house. This area is approximately 4 feet wide by 25 feet long. And essentially it's just an aesthetic request. It makes the walkway going to the front door symmetrical with the front door. Those are the 4 items that we amended for this request. Like I said, originally there were 7 items we were requesting. We reduced those items that the Conservation Commission weren't in favor of, and this is the proposal tonight. And with that, I'll take any questions.
Questions for the applicant? Mr. Gamester.
Steve, is there still a generator, and if so, where did it move to?
Yep, generator's in the same location.
The same with the 4 AC units?
Oh. You got it, yep.
Other questions for the applicant?
I have a question.
Yeah, Ms. Walker.
Had any work been started on the western gate? Because it was going to be, was there a trench dug or some kind of electricity provided to that portion?
The owners are in the rear there, and they're saying no.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions for the applicant? Thanks, Steve. I'll open up the public hearing.
Thank you.
Anyone wishing to speak to for or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I do remember this application, so I'll go forward with it.
Yep.
I'll make a motion that we vote to grant the wetland conditional use permit as presented.
Motion, a second.
Second.
We have a second discussion. So my only comment is, I recently saw this property from Sagamore Creek, and I have to compliment the homeowners for maintaining significant tree coverage. And the house, in fact, fits the space, even though it's quite large. So overall, it's a really impressive project from my perspective. Any other comments? I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The motion passes.
Thank you.
Item 3, other business, the request for the Unitarian Universal Church of Portsmouth owner for property located at 73 Court Street for a 1-year extension. If I could have a motion to determine that no change has taken place that would materially affect the current site plan approval and approve a 1-year extension of the site plan approval to expire on September 21st, 2019.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? The motion passes. Item B, Mr. Kissel, you will be recusing yourself.
Yep.
Request a Foundry Place LLC owner for property located at 181 Hill Street, Lot 6, for a 1-year extension of site plan review approval by the Planning Board. If I could have a motion.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion passes. Thank you. Oh, you have one other item. We have to do a schedule.
Yeah, one item related to scheduling. Some of you might have already had on your calendar that we had a planning board meeting on the 20th. We had, for some reason, had that meeting on the 27th originally, but we're going to be consistent and stay with the 20th. We don't really recall why that happened. So the revised schedule's in front of you. It's just consistent with our normal meeting time. So
our next meeting is the third Thursday of September.
Yep.
Normal September 20th.
Okay.
Any other business?
Question for Juliet. On
yes.
The items from last week, like the sign ordinance, when are we going to be seeing that, is that slated for September with Rick, or?
We're going to just check in with Rick and see if we have time to make some revisions for you guys for next meeting. That would be my preference. If anybody has changes they want to send to me, feel free to do that. So that would be my preference, like, we'll kind of see what the load is on applications and so forth. Doesn't look too heavy yet, so.
So while we're speaking of changes to the ordinance, you gave us a list a couple meetings ago of sort of the top four.
Yep.
And then others. Any update on that, or is it a little bit early to ask?
Yeah, so we actually have a few drafts already in place, and I'll take a look at that. We could potentially bring another one forward. I can't remember which one's next in line. But I know we have some accessory dwelling unit changes.
Chickens.
The chickens were kind of low on the
I think it was low.
Jillian, do you recall the accessory dwelling units? What was the other one that we have already drafted? Do you remember? Yeah. So accessory dwelling unit, I think, is probably one
probably
that
we'll
bring to you guys next. And I can't remember the other one, but okay. we have a few drafted already, so. Yeah, I mean, if we have time next month and not a heavy load, maybe we could bring that one forward as well.
Sure, yeah, if it's ready and
okay.
it fits.
Okay.
Like we talked before, I think we just want to be certain that we have enough time to spend on these
right.
and not have them late in the evening.
Yep.
Any other feedback for Juliet or questions, or then let's look for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, everybody.
Do all those
have a nice